May 1981, 118 years to the day, living history buffs from 11 states gathered on the actual ground to reenact the Battle of Champion Hill, key engagement of the Vicksburg Campaign. Through the efforts of these historians, we can now go back in time to see the battle, much as a television news camera would have. So, leave the modern world behind and step back into another bloodier, tragic time. It is spring, 1863. The third summer of the American Civil War. Since the firing on Fort Sumter, there have been 500 battles that have already yielded a harvest of 500,000 casualties, and the end is nowhere in sight. At the beginning of the war, the South closed the Mississippi River to northern commerce. The Midwest could no longer send out its great supplies of crops and raw materials. The South, however, was continuously supplied with horses, cattle, guns, and ammunition from the western states of Louisiana, Texas, and Arkansas. The North, by amassing forces on the borders and effectively blockading the southern coastal waters, has closed three sides of a rectangular stronghold around the Deep South. It is now ready to take the Mississippi River, thereby driving a blue wedge into the gray heart of the Confederacy, closing the box and splitting the South. Memphis and New Orleans have fallen. But to control the Mississippi, Vicksburg, the Gibraltar of the Confederacy, must be taken. Vicksburg, the citadel, perched atop 200-foot bluffs and controlling the mile-wide river. Vicksburg must be taken. War weariness of the North dictates it. Election year policies dictate it. Strategic necessity dictates it. Vicksburg must be taken. In April of 1863, Union General Ulysses S. Grant starts yet another effort against Vicksburg. He has tried five times before. Vicksburg must be taken. During the last part of April, Grant moves his army south of Vicksburg on the Louisiana side of the river to Hard Times Landing. He crosses the river on transports brought south through the fire of the Vicksburg batteries. Pushing forward, Grant wins a victory on May 1st at Port Gibson. This outflanks a Confederate garrison at Grand Gulf to the north, forcing the Southerners to evacuate their batteries. General John C. Pemberton, the Confederate commander at Vicksburg, is in a state of indecision. Not only has Grant confused things by a demonstration north of Vicksburg and a cavalry raid through the state of Mississippi, Pemberton must contend with conflicting orders. General Joseph Johnson, the department commander, has ordered the city of Vicksburg evacuated and a link-up of forces to defeat Grant. President Jefferson Davis has ordered the city of Vicksburg to be held at all costs. In a rapid campaign to get behind Vicksburg, Grant meets and defeats Confederate forces outside of Raymond on May 12th. This action shows Grant that Confederates are at Jackson, the state capital. In a bold change of plans, Grant determines to take Jackson. On May 14th, he captures and burns the Capitol. Confederates, who could have attacked him from behind, are forced to withdraw. Having secured his army's rear, Grant turns west towards his goal, Vicksburg. General Pemberton now decides on a course of action. He moves east, across the Big Black River, hoping to defeat Grant. By May 15th, Union and Confederate armies are converging on the railhead of Edwards Station, halfway point between Vicksburg and Jackson. It is the 16th day of the Vicksburg campaign. During this night, the eve before the battle, the opposing forces unknowingly camp within 4 miles of each other. The Confederates along Baker's Creek, and the Union troops on the other side of a high ridge.
General Grant, you've now burned Jackson after you've moved from the Mississippi to this point. What are your plans at this time?
The investiture of Vicksburg.
You do, of course, realize in this movement you've made from the river to Jackson, you are contrary to the orders of your immediate superior in this theater. If you are therefore not successful, you will be heavily censured for this move. Does this in any way bother you?
Any general who does not succeed in combat is heavily censured. I am not at this time aware that I am acting beyond my bounds as military commander of the Department of Tennessee. You may have intelligence to the contrary, but I can assure you, sir, I am operating completely within my sphere of influence.
General Pemberton, the first question I'd like to ask you is, why have you waited this long to move your troops out of Vicksburg, knowing that Grant was moving on Jackson and having to figure he'd probably come in the back door?
Well, we have had several reports from the War Department saying how important Vicksburg is and that it must be held at all costs, especially from President Davis himself. We know there are troops at Snyder's Bluff that have made demonstrations against our defenses, and General Johnston has not sent reinforcements as I have requested him on several occasions, and we feel that the fortress of Vicksburg is very important, cannot be lost at any cost.
Do you think you can hold Grant's troops here?
We think we can crush his army. He is in a perilous situation. He is deep inside hostile territory. We have heard reports that servants have been giving him information and leading him the way. We are sure that they are doing it. They are rather misguided. They do not realize that these men are out to do them harm. But they are still in hostile territory and a very long way from Boonesburg. So we are confident that our men will crush his army and pinch him between General Johnston, if General Johnston will move, and myself.
Early on the morning of May 16th, 1863, the Union troops begin skirmishing with Confederate troops on that high ridge. The ridge is called Champion Hill.
Thank you.
By 10 in the morning, the skirmish has become a full-fledged battle.
Fire two!
Blow them Yankees to hell!
At first, a Union assault drives the Confederates off Champion Hill. A fierce Confederate counterattack drives the blue-clad soldiers back. Just arrived from the town of Clinton a few miles away, grasps the desperate situation. A defeat here will cost his entire army. Ordering up reinforcements, he attacks again. Pemberton, sensing this renewed assault by Grant, calls for more reinforcements. One of his generals, W.W. Loring, off chasing Grant's non-existent supply lines, does not come. The Union assault drives the Confederate line on Champion Hill back. The hill changes hands for the third time. By 4 p.m, the Confederates are beaten, and they fall back toward the fortress of Vicksburg. Sadly, Pemberton realizes it is only a matter of time until Vicksburg falls. Grant knows it too.
Would you sum up today's events for us?
Well, early this morning, General Hovey of General McClernand's Corps engaged the enemy near a place called Champion Hill. And initially, they were thrown back, but when reinforcements came up, they broke the Confederate line by late afternoon. As you can see, the main fighting's just ended. Our forces are continuing to chase the Confederates before they get to the Big Black, trying to destroy Pemberton's army. And if we can catch him before he gets across the river, we'll do that.
Do you anticipate any trouble at the Big Black?
Oh, I'm sure we'll have another engagement. Trouble is what this entire war is all about.
Do you foresee any problem with taking the city of Vicksburg now?
I have not seen any problem whatsoever other than natural obstacles to taking the city of Vicksburg. It's my intention within the next few days to assault the city and take it by storm.
What do you think of the Rebel Army? What is your snap judgment on the Rebel Army that you have met in this theater of operations in Mississippi?
My judgment of the Confederate forces, that national forces have been engaging since the start of this conflict. They're a very dedicated group of men. At the Battle of Shiloh, I was under the delusion that one quick victory would cause most of these men to give up and go home. Shiloh was an education for me in that I found out that these men were dedicated to their cause, and I knew that it would be an extremely hard fight. I believe they're good men because they're Americans, and I am fighting with all my heart to bring these men back into the fold of the United States so that we can all be Americans again. I do believe, however, that their cause is one of the most unholy that man has ever fought for.
Why is it worth it to you to kill them to bring them back into the fold? Why can you not just let them go?
It was not my judgment to kill them. We did not fire the first shots. We did not secede. We did not break our oaths. There are many West Pointers in the Confederate States Army that gave their oath to support the United States and the Constitution, and under even pain of death. Those men revoked that oath. I feel that men who stayed in the United States Army are honorable men. I feel that the members who went to the Confederate Army are also honorable men, but under a great delusion.
After an unsuccessful stand at the Big Black River, Pemberton's Confederates occupy the fortifications of Vicksburg itself. Here, finally, they repel two major assaults. Grant sets siege to Vicksburg. On July 4th, 1863, after a heroic 47-day siege, Pemberton surrenders the city of Vicksburg to Grant. For the second time, Grant accepts the surrender of a Confederate army. The mortal wound has been inflicted on the Southern cause. It will take two more years to die. Many years later, Sir Winston Churchill, writing of the American Civil War, reiterated famous historian J.F.C. Fuller. The drums of Champion Hill sounded the doom of Richmond.
Next step. You're about to take it. That important next step from high school to what comes after graduation. You have some choices, you know. You can look for a job, maybe even find one that pays minimum wage or better. Or you can continue your education for a few more years. One or two or four or more. whatever it takes to prepare yourself for a lifetime career. Some of you have already made plans. Others of you are just laid back, waiting, wondering, undecided. College should be the next step. As most of you know, college offers you lots of options. At Mississippi Gulf Coast Community College, we understand how important it is for you to make the right choices. We've been helping young people to do that for 75 years. During that time, Gulf Coast graduates have become doctors, plumbers, lawyers, welders, bankers, nurses, politicians, carpenters, astronauts. You name it, they've done it and are doing it. So can you, if college is your next step. At Gulf Coast, you can choose from dozens of academic transfer programs or more than 40 technical and vocational fields. You can choose to live on campus at Perkinston or commute to the Jefferson Davis or Jackson County campuses or any one of the four centers. There's one close to where you live. And Gulf Coast is affordable. Tuition, including books, is less than half of what it costs to attend a state university. Paying for an education can be a problem, so Gulf Coast offers a variety of financial aid programs that include grants, scholarships, loans, work-study jobs, or a combination of these. Of course, you go to college to get an education, and Gulf Coast is dedicated to helping you achieve that goal. The college transfer program is made up of subjects that lead to the bachelor's degree. Technical and vocational programs prepare students for employment. Additionally, there's a cooperative education program that enables students to gain work experience and earn college credit at the same time. 2+2 is another popular program. It's conducted jointly by Gulf Coast and the Gulf Park and Jackson County branches of the University of Southern Mississippi. This higher education package offers bachelor's degree coursework in selected areas. Students in the program don't have to leave the coast to attend classes. Records show that Gulf Coast graduates who go on to senior institutions do as well as or better than students who began as freshmen at the universities or four-year colleges. Whether you pick an academic program or choose an occupational career, you're assured of having instructors who want you to make it and who give you that extra little push you may need to succeed. And if you are weak in some subjects, there are learning labs on each campus where you can find help in reading, writing, math, science, and accounting. These modern, well-equipped labs serve students by providing instructors and materials to meet student needs. Tutorial sessions are arranged for individuals and groups. The labs also offer enriching programs for honors students. Students in the honors program attend college on scholarships awarded to them for outstanding academic achievement. Other students with high ACT scores and exceptional records in high school also are eligible for scholarships. The classroom side of education is important, but Gulf Coast also affords students the opportunity to participate in out-of-class activities, everything from theater to sports to cookouts. Perkinston, Gulf Coast's boarding campus, offers a traditional style of college life with its dorms and the intercollegiate sports and band programs that are headquartered there. The Jackson County and Jefferson Davis campuses have their own brand of college life, sparked by club events, intramurals, and community-related service projects. All three campuses have student centers, game rooms, and cafeterias. As you can see, Gulf Coast is unique in its multi-campus, one-college concept that makes it easy and pleasant for students to take the next step. To sum it up, Gulf Coast is close to where you live. You can go to college and hold down a job at the same time. We're able to offer you a good education at a comparatively low cost. We offer personalized education. It's possible because we're small enough to care about each student, but large enough to have the human and physical resources to meet the requirements of today's complex society. We help you learn through courses of study which feature hands-on experience as well as traditional lectures. Gulf Coast really is the next step.